Thank you, Melissa. My name is Chris. I'm the next generation director here at St. John.
And I'm Steve Hauer. I'm the new pastor here, and I'm going to be given the privilege of teaching today. And we're in a new series called Puzzled, and it's going to be a different kind of teaching series. You know, that song may have seemed too pedestrian to you, the way that lyric talked about God and the conversation a person has with them. That's because we tend to be very polite. We tend to be very sophisticated when we talk about the truth of God. And you're too polite to ask some questions, and we're too afraid to try to answer. But this series is going to skip all of that. We're going to get right down and deal with the really tough stuff. Today we're talking about you didn't really expect me to believe that in the Bible? I mean, that's a pretty far-fetched story that the Bible lays out there. How can I believe that with any kind of integrity? So we're going to be talking about those kinds of things in this series, and that's what we're talking about today. I pray the whole series is a blessing, and I pray for God's wisdom today as I do that teaching.
So thank you all so much for being here. If you are a guest with us today, we want to just make a special welcome to you. We hope that you've already been made to feel welcome by our awesome volunteers as you came in the building today. If you are watching online through our live stream, we also want to welcome you today. So just thanks for being here on this first weekend of the new year.
Yes, and we have had a lot of visitors over the course of the special services that we had throughout December. In fact, we had a new record attendance in December for attendance. So. Incredible. Very blessed by that, and thank you for inviting your friends. There may be some folks who came back because they heard about this series. If you are new here, you'll find in your pew rack ahead of you some cards there. There's one that calls new here, and you can fill that out, drop it in the offering plate so that we can get to know more about you and connect with you in a different way. Or you can just bring it back to the welcome station in the lobby, and I think they have a gift to acknowledge you there.
And for some of you who have been checking us out maybe for a couple of weeks or a couple of months, we also offer something called Getting Started. And our next one is next Sunday, January 11th at 9 a.m. We want to encourage you to come to that. It's a great opportunity for you to learn more about St. John and some next steps that you can take to plug in here. It also gives us a chance to get to know you a little bit. So please look at that.
We offer the Lord's Supper on the first and third weekend of every month. This is the first weekend of a new year, and so the Lord's Supper has been set. If you wonder whether you should receive or not receive the Lord's Supper based on Scripture, take a look at the inside flap of your communication device, and there's an explanation there about what the Bible teaches and what we offer in this meal. We certainly welcome you if you abide faithful to those things.
So we're going to be here for about 65 or 70 minutes this morning, but right now we want to encourage you to stand up, greet someone around you, tell them what you're anticipating most about the new year.
Thrilled to have you here. The worship music is outstanding today, and it's right on point as we deal with the things that puzzle us in our faith and belief in the one true God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So much stronger. forgetting, or we're hurting, or we're a little bit broken, and there are answers to questions that we just can't find. And that's why we want to just invite you at this time to sing the words of this song, this profession of the faith in the God who loves you, who's cared for you, and has a wonderful plan for you. It's in His name we sing. Demonstrate that love. We ask that your Spirit would come to us today and pour into our lives, that through your word and through your sacrament here in the Lord's Supper, that we would receive the touch, the reassurance of faith, that You love us. You died for us. And you've called us by name. Help our doubts to be chased away. Help our questions to be somewhat resolved in the assurance that you know what's best and that you are our God. And it's in your Son's name we ask all this. Amen. You may be seated.
As we prepare to give to God on this, the first weekend of the new year, I just want to share a proverb with you. So it's going to be up on the screen behind me. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. If you're looking for a great investment strategy for the new year, God is saying, trust me with the first of your crops, of your dividends, your paychecks, however blessings come, and when you do, I will make sure you get the rest. You will have what you need all year long. What an incredible promise. Will there be ups and downs? Of course there will be. But God is promising that he will not leave us hanging. So now we have an opportunity to honor the Lord with the first of our wealth of the new year. But before our volunteers come forward, I'd like to tell you how we closed out 2014. Through the I Love My Church campaign, you heard amazing stories of people's lives that were being changed by God's work in them. We also heard amazing stories of how God is doing incredible things just in this place. But we also put before you a financial goal of $75,000 above and beyond our normal December giving. It seemed insurmountable. Well, we exceeded that goal by $20,000 to finish this year in the black. I am so proud of our church, but even more, I am so grateful for God's favor here. We are now positioned in a place where God is going to continue to do great things, I know, in 2015. And I hope you're excited because God is at work here. And the incredible things that we've already seen are only the first fruits of greater things to come. So I hope you see that and you believe it. Would you pray with me, please? Father, thank you so much for your goodness. God, you show us your love and your favor in so many ways. And God, it has overwhelmed us seeing that favor, especially over this last month. God, thank you for the ways that we see you working in the life of this church. Lord, for the way that we see you working in the lives of individuals here to draw them closer to you, to help them to become more passionate about you. Lord, the way that we see people going out into the community and telling others about you, bringing them here so that they can hear more about your mercy and your grace. God, thank you for showing that to us. God, we ask that in this new year, Lord, as we see the opportunities and we anticipate all the many ways that you're going to work here, God, may you just make us people who are available. God, may we be willing, may we be obedient to be used by you. God, we thank you and we look forward to this great year ahead. Bless this time and we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Volunteers, would you please come forward as we give back to God? You can also give electronically at stjstl.net/give. Uncommon core values from academics to leadership to spiritual development, St. John's School offers outstanding opportunities from early childhood all the way through eighth grade. And if you'd like to hear more about our school and all that it has to offer, either this year, for the remainder of this year, or for the coming year ahead, we'd like to invite you to our admission open house, which is going to happen on Thursday, January 22nd at 7 p.m. We'd love to be able to share with you our vision of how St. John will help shape your child and your family. Also, the new year finds us kicking off all kinds of new groups and studies. I want to tell you about two of those real quick. One is our unemployment seminar for anyone who may be looking for a job. Also, if there's anyone out there that is newly engaged, we have a premarital mentoring group that starts on January 17th. So we want to encourage all of you to pick up a groups and studies booklet at the information station out in our lobby. That will tell you about all the groups and studies that are beginning this month. For more information on all of this, as well as other events and programs here at St. John, we'd like to encourage you to look at your communication piece. Also, visit us online at stjstl.net.
I'm always like you, I'm kind of interested in what the title package is going to look like for a new series. Our guys do a good job, don't they? Just really excellent. So, as you can tell by the title, you know, this is kind of a different series. And in fact, even as I prepared this message and studied for it with also Pastor Dion and we broke it out, you know, we're going to do something a little different than we normally do, and it requires a different teaching form for us as well, because normally we're about life issues, we're about relational issues, you know, we're about things that God reveals through His stories and through His teaching that would help us engage our life and make a difference in things that matter. Throughout this series, though, we're going to be dealing with the things that cause stumble, the things that cause confusion, the things that cause doubt in the heart of a Christian. And it's just essential that we address those things so that you can trust in the teaching, so you can trust in the lessons of life that come out of those other stories. So I'm going to play professor a little bit, and I'm going to spend a lot of time by that TV and walk you through some scripture and walk you through some points that reveal issues that have caused us to stumble. Today we're going to be talking about some of the far-fetched stories that are found in the Bible that seem impossible, and yet they are presented as historic fact in the Scripture. Today we're going to be talking about Noah's ark and the flood, so we should pray about this. Let's do that. Gracious Lord, we ask Your favor and Your blessing on this time. May the words of my mouth, what I say, may they just be honest and candid, and help me, Lord, to say what You have revealed, and help me not to go beyond Your word and add my wisdom. Certainly we're going to have questions. There are places where Your Bible is silent. There are things that we are curious about that You don't think that we need to know. Help us to know the difference between the truth that You reveal and the things that You don't reveal, and the things that are only mere speculation. Help also the hearts of those assembled today, Lord, to be open, to listen, and to receive, answers from your word that may help them with their own doubts, their own questions, and also as they interact with others. An increasing number of people in our society who are unchurched and who think that we are a bit simplistic in our approach. Lord, so bless my words and bless the listening of those in front of me, and grant that through this process we would all be stronger in faith. And this we ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. So maybe you saw this billboard. It was in St. Louis and a couple of places, and it was a national campaign by the Atheist Society. I don't know if you don't believe in something, why you spend so much time trying to disprove it. It seems odd to me. But dear Santa, all I want for Christmas is to skip church. I'm too old for fairy tales. And when it comes to stories like Noah's Ark, that's what a lot of people believe. And if you go and see the movies that Hollywood produces about these things, you would tend to believe that that's true. You know, these things are just beyond imagination, beyond any reasonable person's ability to accept. You know, this is the new year, and I know in the new year, a lot of people come back to church for the first time, or they make New Year's resolutions. I'm going to get physically fit. You know, I'm going to diet. You know, I'm going to exercise, and I'm going to develop my spiritual life. I'm going to get my finances in order. You know, all the different things that we say. And one family had made that decision. They knew that they had been out of church for a while. They used the reason that their kids were too small and disruptive in church, and suddenly their oldest child was 10 years old, and they thought, wow. You know, we have neglected this part of his teaching. And so throughout the Christmas season, they realized that they need to get back into church, especially for their child. And so they brought him to Sunday school. And he was a bit hesitant because that was outside of his experience, you know, to go to Sunday school. And they said, it'll be fine, it'll be fine. And we'll be anxious to hear what you learn. And so after Sunday school, they debriefed over a donut somewhere. And he said, Dad, Sunday school is so cool. He said, you won't believe it. He said, we learned a story about an Israeli special forces commando named Moses. And he was sent into Egypt to rescue some POWs from Egypt. And he organized them, and they had a huge breakout. It was amazing. And he said, the whole Egyptian army came after them with tanks and armed troops. And he said they came through some oil fields and they lit them on fire, and in the smoke and in the confusion, the Egyptian army was delayed while other engineers built pontoon bridges across the Red Sea. And Moses brought his POWs across the pontoon bridges, and the Egyptian army began to follow. And Moses radioed ahead, and the Israeli Air Force sent some fighter bombers in. And just when the Egyptian army was in the middle of the Red Sea, they blew them out of the water. They all fell in and drowned. His dad knew a little bit more about the Bible than his son thought, and he said, "Now, he said, I'm glad that you're excited about Sunday school. I'm glad that you went." He said, "But honestly, your teacher didn't really tell you that." He said, "Well, no, that wasn't exactly what he said. But if I told you the whopper that he laid on us, you would never believe it. Never believe it. Never believe it." You know, we're talking about some pretty far-fetched things when we talk about things like the flood, when we talk about, you know, walking across the Red Sea on dry ground. I mean, amazing things. Believers and non-believers are not connecting on matters of faith. And it's confusing to all of us. You know, in fact, it's become a subject that we hesitate to talk about. What seems perfectly logical to Christians seems, by all objective standards, to be absolute foolishness to those who don't believe. And we're puzzled by that. I mean, it just seems, you know, so real to us. You know, we're convicted by our faith and by the Holy Spirit that, you know, we just think everyone would believe and accept the fact that these things are true. And non-Christians, on the other hand, respect us, work alongside us, consider us intelligent. You know, we've gone to school with them, we work with them, they're colleagues of ours. Sometimes we even lead them to resolve difficult matters at work. They have huge respect for us, and they can't believe that we could be so foolish in the simplistic notions that we believe about God, about good and evil, about faith as the ultimate solution to all of life's problems. You know, a few years ago, I wrote a book called Contrary to Popular Belief, because I would have person after person would send me a letter or talk to me and say, Pastor, my folks just don't believe this stuff, and how can I convince my college-age student that these stories are real and these things actually happened, and why don't they believe? It just seems so clear, and what can I say to them? And my answer would be, well, say to them they're right. This is foolishness. You know, the Bible says the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of men. You know, but what we believe is beyond reasonable. You know, we're about to receive the Lord's Supper, and in with and under bread and wine, the Lord gives us his body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins and the strengthening of our faith. How is that reasonable? You know, last week, I baptized like 7 different people. I don't know if you saw it, but we even did an immersion out at the YMCA. It was an incredible experience. And how can you believe that you can take water and put it on a person and something spiritually happens there? I mean, it's an unreasonable belief. In that book, in that prologue, I wrote these couple of paragraphs. Christians and their non-believing friends need to make some bold admissions. The Christian faith doesn't always make sense. Amen? Doesn't make sense to you, doesn't make sense to me. You know, I teach it, and still I can't always explain it. I take some things just on faith. Let's go on. It is often illogical, it's incredibly simplistic, and it requires a belief in miracles, which by definition requires acceptance of the impossible. I mean, these things, when they say, that's impossible, I say, you know, you're right. It's impossible. You're a good Bible student. No one can argue any person into the faith, and Christians should cease to try. You know, it's by God's word. We tell the stories, we tell our faith, we say, this is what I believe for me, and we expect that the Holy Spirit will do what our words and our arguments cannot do. Continues. That doesn't mean that the Christian faith cannot be defended. Now, you know, it requires faith in miracles, but it can still be defended. It's a historic faith. Let's go on. Reputable apologists, that's defenders or people who explain, have shown through verifiable historic prophecy, no question, these scriptures were written before they were fulfilled, and they were fulfilled as these scriptures, which even the greatest skeptic would acknowledge preceded the event, actually occurred. And the fulfillment of that God is as good as his word. You know, he predicted it happened. Yes, we can't deny that. And credible archaeologists have authenticated the history of the Bible over and over, often silencing skeptics who had previously argued that such battles, such people, and such cities could not be substantiated. There's no evidence those things ever happened. And then they discovered them with archaeology. The Christian faith is a historic faith. It's not like Hinduism. It's not like Buddhism. You know, it's people, times, and places, cities and rivers and mountains that you can go and see if they are there. It can be verified. And the centuries are littered with evidence of those who have courageously lived out the events that the Bible describes. And yet, it's amazing that people still struggle. And I understand that people still struggle about these things. In fact, on Facebook, this past week, even it's almost like God ordained, you know, there was a post on Facebook. They often post news stories now on Facebook. And one said, Noah's Ark has been discovered. Why are they keeping it from us? And I thought, here we go again. That's like Madeline Murray O'Hare, you know, is going to take In God We Trust off our money. You know, it just occurs every 5 years or so. And I just thought, well, I've heard this all before. By the way, I don't believe that even if they did discover it, it would change anything. I mean, people saw Jesus do miracles, and they didn't believe in him. You know, finding a piece of wood on Mount Ararat isn't going to change anybody's faith. That's not how it happens. But in response, it's interesting to see what people post in response to such an article like that. Chris McGinnis says, His Majesty's Titanic, height 175 feet, length 882 feet, width 92 feet, construction steel, capacity over 3,500 souls, and enough provision for a couple of weeks. Noah's Ark, by contrast, smaller, height 45 feet, length 450 feet, width 75 feet, construction wood. And yet over 50,000 animals, 2 million insects, 7 people, and a 600-year-old captain who had enough provisions for a year. Science has proven the myth alive for years. That's just 1% of the facts on why the Ark is a fake myth. But look at Nick down below. If you're a believer, you don't need proof. All you really need, you know, you already know the truth. Facts be damned. You know, I know what I believe, and what I believe is true, is what Nick would say. Well, let's take a look at it in the scripture. It occupies three chapters, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Actually, that's four chapters, isn't it? And I wasn't going to stand up here and read four chapters to you, so I excerpted portions of chapters, but I do want to read and not just tell you this story so that you actually see God's word on this matter. So from 6, first of all, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. And the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled by what he saw. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race which I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Interesting that the Lord still knows the faithful, even in the midst of unfaithfulness. I'm going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens. Every creature that has the breath of life in it, everything on earth will perish. But I will establish my covenant with you, Noah, and you will enter the ark, you and your sons, three sons, and your three wives with you, their three wives. You are to bring into the ark two of all living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you, two of every kind of bird, of every kind of animal, and of every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. You are to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and store it away as food for you and for them. And then it happened. The waters rose and covered the mountains to a depth of more than 15 cubits, about 25 feet above the highest mountain. Every living thing that moved on the land perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, all the creatures that swarmed over the earth, and all mankind. Everything on dry land that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. People and animals and the creatures that moved along the ground and the birds were wiped from the face of the earth. Only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. The waters flooded the earth for 150 days. As they used to say, thus far the reading. Now, there are 10 points that I want to quickly make, and I'm not going to elaborate a lot, but 10 points that we can make from the Bible about this account based on Scripture and based on verifiable evidence. First, with variations, the biblical account of a universal flood is part of the mythology and legend of almost every culture on earth. This is a quote. Even people living far from the sea, the Hopi Indians of the American Southwest, and even the Incas in Peru, have legends of a great flood washing over the land, covering the tops of the mountains and wiping out virtually all life on earth. This is from a book called Doomsday, The Science of Catastrophe. It's interesting that every culture has a story like this, has a flood epic. In China, you'll find that in the discoveries that they've made in Mesopotamia, in the ancient cultures of the Persians and in the Egyptians, you have flood epics. How is that possible that cultures that apparently grew up far removed from each other still have the same story if they did not have the same origin? The story varies over time as people retell any story. It varies, but all of them have this in common, which suggests that all of them have a common origin. All of them came out of that experience through the three sons and their wives of Noah. All of them have the same history, despite the fact that they spread over the face of the earth. Point number two. Fossil records show the remains of sea life on the highest peaks. You know, even in the Himalayas, they have discovered seashells on the highest peaks of all the mountains. In fact, there is a discovery that was made, and it was actually reported in the Chemical and Engineering News of Washington, D.C., of the skeleton of a baleen whale, 90 feet long, standing on its tail in the mountains of California. Now, it's in a kind of ground that has been slowly uncovered that takes, they say, millions of years for it to form. Now, that whale did not stand there on its tail for a million years, you know, while ground slowly built around it, you know, through sediment. It could have never happened that way. It looks as though some traumatic event, you know, caught that whale in that position and quickly covered it, which would tend to lead you to believe that perhaps there was such a thing as a flood or a great shift, and the mountain suddenly swept up and caught that animal in such a way in which it was quickly buried and then later fossilized. So clearly, all ground on Earth has at one time been underwater. That cannot be denied. The atmosphere and conditions of the earth were vastly different before the flood. And in fact, you could talk about life before the flood and you could talk about life after the flood. Almost like you could talk about life before sin and after sin. The flood changed everything. Let me just point out a few of the things that changed. The lives of people before the flood were much longer. In fact, it tells us in Genesis 6, verse 3, the Lord said, "My spirit will not contend with humans forever, for they are mortal. Their days will be 120 years. God saw, if you have enough time, you can you can take evil to new levels of distortion. And we know that in the chapter previous to this, that when he first meets Noah, Noah is 500 years old. When the flood comes, it says Noah was 600 years old. So there was probably 100 years there in which there was involvement in construction. We know in that also that same chapter of Genesis chapter 5, it lists a lot of the great patriarchs of old, and Methuselah, well known to even most children, is the oldest living person recorded in the Bible, 969 years. How is that possible? Well, I do think conditions on earth would have been more conducive to old age before the flood as opposed to after the flood. UV rays age us, and I believe that the conditions before the flood held a lot of those UV rays back, but I don't think that it's the full explanation. I think it was a decision made by God that quickly changed the world. He was going to recreate the world, and he was going to do it in such a way that man's limitations would be imposed by age, and so evil could not flourish to the way it had before. But we do know that before the flood, people lived much longer than they do after the flood. Abraham lived 120 years, and that was considered old age. You know, so it changes different, vastly different going on. It had not rained on the earth prior to the flood. That's an interesting truth. In fact, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, a mist came up from the ground and watered the surface of the earth. Before the flood came, it didn't rain. In fact, the whole conditions of the earth were tropical. I think the northern pole and the southern pole, all tropical. The whole world was tropical, which similar to the movies that you've seen where dinosaurs walk through tropical jungles. I believe that the whole world was like that. I want to explain how that could be in just a minute. But we know that it just says a mist came up. You know, it was just condensation, you know, constantly like misters, you know, coming up. Rain had not yet fallen, so when it began to rain, that must have been quite a scary and novel thing for people to experience. Next point. The Earth's atmosphere seems similar to a terrarium prior to the flood. You know what a terrarium is? Back in the day, in the 70s, they were popular. People grew environments in this big round ball, and they would go in there with long tweezers, and they would plant things, and it was a self-sustaining world, and it was very tropical, and people would grow these and display them in their homes. So I believe the earth existed that way, which explains, you know, why you can find oil in desert regions today, because we all know that oil is nothing but vegetation, that mass fields of vegetation that have been put under pressure that have created fossil fuel. And so you will find those in deserts where there is no vegetation. You'll find them in Alaska, you know, where it's too cold for vegetation. But at one time, there was vegetation there and a great deal of it. Here's what it says in the Bible about creation. God said, "Let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water." So God made the vault, and he separated the waters under the vault, which were on the earth, from the waters which were above the vault. You know, this huge bubble that the world was encased in. And it was so. God called the vault sky, you know, the sky. And then there was this huge water surrounding the earth. And there was evening and there was morning the second day. that's what the scripture says. And I believe that would have created a very different earth than the one we experience now. The flood then came in three sources of water. You say, how could possibly 40 days of rain cause the earth to flood and to cover all the mountains? Well, it wasn't just rain. It says that water came up out of the ground, great sources of water underground. The whole vault above the sky that created a very thick atmosphere, unlike the one that we now have, and also rain came. So here's how it says it in the Bible. It says, in the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened. And rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. So the floodgates were opened, all that water came down, all the water came up, and it also rained for 40 days and for 40 nights. So we know that the Bible describes a condition that we have never, ever experienced since then. Now, after the flood, we know that Noah came out of the ark, and he built an altar to God for sparing his family, and God put a rainbow in the sky, and he promised that he would never destroy the earth like he had until the final judgment. Here's how it's described in the Bible. Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals, he took seven of all the clean animals, only two of every other kind of animal, and clean birds, and he sacrificed burnt offerings on that altar. And the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, and he said in his heart, never again will I curse the ground because of the humans. You know, they can't help themselves. They're sinful by nature. Every inclination of their heart is evil from childbirth. Even the best of us, you know, are not perfect and far from it. Never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. So after the flood, God has promised that there will not be a destruction like that again until Christ returns. Also, after the flood, it's clear that worldwide geographical evidence suggests that water shaped our land. If you've traveled at all and you've been to coastal regions, you know that there is an appearance as the coast goes down to meet the land, there are these coastal shelves that indicate that water has receded and it used to be much higher than it is. In fact, even our Mississippi River Valley or the Missouri River Valley, in places it's 10 miles wide. Certainly that river has never been that big, except perhaps when the floodwaters receded and shaped these huge channels, and now we have a river that's just a few hundred yards wide flowing down the middle. But the Mississippi River Valley, you could stand on one huge ridge and walk see all the way across to another ridge. Water has never been that great. Even the Grand Canyon, I propose, is probably better explained as being caused by forces of water rather than an ice age, which some scientific people believe, which is also pure speculation. So worldwide geographical evidence suggests that water shaped our land. Finally, the last point. The total days in the ark, if you add them all up, you know, when land was first discovered until he finally came out and offered his sacrifice, were 371 days. That's what we know from the biblical account. There are other things, but those are 10 of the more obvious things that I wanted to point out. Now, let me just point out there are some things that we don't know. Some things about the flood that we don't know and get in trouble when we speculate about. These are everything else. You know, and this is what is a bit annoying for me to go and see these movies. I don't know if you've seen this one about Moses right now that's out there, Gods and Kings. I went to see it. I just have to see it, you know. Rather than be faithful to the biblical account that says Moses took a vase full of water and he poured it into the Nile and the whole Nile became blood, they have God rather causing crocodiles to eat people and eat things and create blood in the water, which creates flies, which, you know, they have to find reasonable ways to explain miracles. It's a miracle! You know, why does God have to have some reasonable way to create a miracle? You know, it's amazing to me that some people say, well, I believe that God created the world, but I don't believe he did it in 7 days. Like, you know, I think he could do that, but I think he would need more time, like maybe 1,000 years, you know, or so. So it's a miracle. Why, I mean, take nothing and make something anyway. Why does it take you know, some reasonable explanation. And in that movie also, they show, you know, how the tornadoes came and caused the waters to separate, and therefore the children of Israel escaped through sloshy puddles of water. It says they went on dry ground. You know, it's a miracle. It's impossible to believe this anyway. Yeah, here are some things that we don't know. Did the animals hibernate? I don't know. How did they survive a year in the ark? I don't know. You know, if you go to the Sight and Sound Museum down in Branson, they'll tell you about that, but otherwise, I don't know. Did dinosaurs survive the flood? I don't know. I know that reptiles grow as long as they live. They never stop growing. In fact, you can tell the age of a reptile by how big it is. If Methuselah lived 969 years, imagine a lizard that lived that long. I don't know. It's just pure speculation. Did Noah hire people to help build the ark? I don't know. I would think he probably did. He was at it for probably about 100 years. Later in the scripture, this story is mentioned often. Let's not forget, and let's remember what I said to begin with, and I think it's good to come back and touch on that. Christians and their non-believing friends need to make some bold admissions. The Christian faith doesn't always make sense. There's a lot about this story that I don't know, and the Bible is silent. It is illogical, incredibly simplistic, and requires a belief in miracles, which by definition requires acceptance of the impossible. It's okay with me. If you struggle to believe in the flood, let me tell you about a virgin who gave birth to a baby. Let me tell you about a man who was put into a tomb and 3 days later he came out. Or that he raised somebody who had been dead 4 days and was in a tomb, and his folks said, don't bring him out, he's gonna smell, he's been in there a long time. And he brought Lazarus out of the tomb. Our faith is based on belief in miracles, so it doesn't create a lot of difficulty for me to believe in the impossible. I know that there are parts of the story that just seem impossible. People would say, that's impossible. I say, you're right. You know, it is impossible. I believe my God can do impossible things. Do you have any other questions? You know, it's just like that. You know, what are some lessons that we can learn? Just 6 quick things from this, and I think it's important as we take apart this story, 6 things that we can learn from the flood. Point number 1, don't fear the destruction of the world by any means other than the final judgment of God. It says, until the end of time, seed time and harvest, fall, spring, winter will continue to roll around. I don't worry as some people worry about nuclear disaster. I do believe that there have been disasters. There have even been man-caused disasters. There have been tsunamis that have destroyed, you know, huge groups of people. Those things will occur, but the destruction of the earth will come only at God's time, not at man's decision, and it will be at the hand of God. Secondly, some would ask, you know, how could God possibly judge the earth in this way? My question is, how could he possibly spare anybody? We're all guilty, and if God is perfect and cannot coexist with the imperfect, why didn't he just destroy us all? But there's something compassionate about God who believed in his creation and wanted to see his creation flourish, and so he decided to spare a family, and from that family reestablish his world. So rather than ask how could he do that, ask how could he save anyone? 3, don't expect Christianity to grow in popularity. You know, some people believe that by electing the new president, a better Congress or a Supreme Court, or by America standing up for God and country, that the world will become a better place. Jesus himself said, in the last days you will be handed over and persecuted and put to death because of your faith. You will be hated by all nations. ISIS should not surprise us. The beheading of Christians should not surprise us. These conditions have been foretold even by the Lord himself because of me. It's like the days of Noah when people mocked the truth about God. So they do today. At that time, many will turn away from the faith. Even Christians will turn away from the faith and say, you know, this just seems to be dangerous and unnecessary, and I'm not so sure it's true. And will be betrayed and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. Jesus himself predicted things are not going to get better, folks. You know, that's why we brace ourselves. That's why we come to church. That's why we live the 6. That's why we do our 15 minutes every day in the Word of God, because we're living in harsh conditions. We're living in unpopular faith in a time that mocks what we believe. Next point. The majority doubted Noah's prediction. They doubted, even though he preached throughout the construction of the ark, they mocked him and thought he was a fool for doing it. The majority will also doubt Christ's second coming. In fact, Peter makes a direct reference to Noah's flood in 2 Peter chapter 3. He says, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come. These are the last days. All the signs are there. All has been fulfilled. The Lord could come at any time. Scoffing and following their evil desires, they will say, where is this coming that he promised? Hogwash. Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it always has from the beginning of creation. Nothing ever changes. Those are just stories. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. And by these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. They forget God already promised to judge the world, and God did judge the world. He's going to do it again. By the same word, the present heavens and the present earth are being reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and the destruction of the ungodly. That day will come. Just because it appears to be delayed does not mean it won't come. Just as Noah preached, the day will come. Then people will be surprised by Jesus' return. You know, there's a scripture that says, surely in the flood of great waters he will not be found. When it began to rain, when the rivers began to swell, when the deeps opened, and when the sky fell on them, everybody believed. But it was too late. As in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people just kept on eating and drinking, thinking these Christians are crazy people. They were marrying and giving in marriage right up until the day that Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the second coming of the Son of Man. There will not be this great revival. There will not be people begging to know more about God. You know, they will be ignoring the Lord right until the end, as they did during the days of Noah. And this is kind of interesting. God compares baptism to the flood. This is in 1 Peter chapter 3. God waited patiently in the days of Noah, Noah preaching the entire time while building the ark. Huge object lesson to the people. What are you doing there, Noah? I'm building an ark. There's going to be a flood. God's going to judge the world. It's not too late. You could still believe. You're crazy. While Noah was building the ark, God was being patient. And in that ark, it turned out only a few people, eight, were saved. Noah's, his wife, his three sons, and their wives. And this water is somewhat like baptism that saves you also, not by removal of dirt from the flesh, but by an appeal to God, trusting in his promises, the Bible says. By passing through the waters, Noah was saved. You know, by passing through the waters of baptism, we have what the scriptures say, you know, forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, it's time to wrap this part of it up, but let me just close with this picture of a man who is considered maybe the greatest scientist of all time, Isaac Newton. Isaac Newton lived in the 17th century in England. He had rudimentary scientific instruments and yet made incredible discoveries about motion, about gravity, and how gravity affected the tides, the moon, even the planetary system. He developed the first reflective telescope so that he could study the heavens, an incredible ability in his time and in his era. And most of his friends were not believers, but he was. And on one occasion, he commissioned a toy to describe the solar system, and he put the sun in the middle, and he put the planets, all the planets that he knew about. There are nine of them, if you count Pluto, but he probably couldn't see nine of them with his rudimentary telescope. But the ones that he could see, he understood how they moved around the Earth. And as you cranked the crank, maybe you've seen one of these things were on wires, and they moved around the sun. And one of his friends came in and saw this instrument that he had made. And he begged Isaac Newton, where'd you get that made? I want to have one of those. That's extraordinary. What you've done is extraordinary. It's incredible. They move at different speeds just like it is in the solar system. And he said, where'd you get that made? He said, no one made it. He said, I know that you designed it, Isaac. I know that you did that. But who made it for you? I would like to commission one for myself. He goes, no, it just showed up. No one made it. He goes, I know somebody made it. Just give me the name of the man who made it. He says, it's amazing to me that I cannot convince you in this childish toy that no one made it. And yet it's only a facsimile of the great universe that we live in, and you think no one made that. How could you possibly believe that this must have a creator and this does not? You know, what's the alternative? If you don't have faith, if you don't believe in God, how do you explain these things then? The Bible describes our faith in this way in Hebrews 11. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. Confidence in things that are coming. I believe the Bible, the authenticity of prophecy, the authenticity of archaeology, I believe it. It's the confidence in things that we hope for. If that's true, then what it says is true. And it's assurance about things that we cannot prove. It's just, I believe it. That is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed. God said, let there be land, let there be animals, let there be birds in the air by God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of evolution, not out of things that preexisted, not made out of anything visible, but only by the word of God. That's what the Bible says faith is. That's what faith requires. What's the alternative? Let's pray. Gracious Lord, it's a lot to swallow, and Christians should not try to defend, but just admit that, yeah, what we believe is impossible, but I believe you're a God who does impossible things. Next question. Help us, Lord, to study these things and to understand the things that you have revealed, and to just be okay with the things that you've not revealed, to have peace about that. We pray this in Christ Jesus. Amen. If you'll rise, as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper, it's always good that we would acknowledge our need for God's forgiveness and his favor and his blessing in our life. There's another story in the Bible. I'm not going to spend a lot of time with it, but it's in Mark chapter 9. And this father who has a son who's epileptic, it doesn't say that, but he would go into these seizures, and he would throw himself into water, and he'd throw himself into the fire, and he couldn't control his body when he'd have these seizures. And the man came to Jesus and said, would you have pity on us? Because he'd heard Jesus was a miracle worker. Would you have pity on us if you can do something, if you can do anything? Jesus said to him, if I can do anything, you can just almost hear him, you know, inflection. He says, all things are possible for those who believe. And immediately the boy's father cried out and said, I do believe. Help me with my doubt. Love that. Love that scripture. It's kind of where I'm at. You know, Lord, I believe, but man, some stuff you asked me to believe, help me with my doubt. If this is where you find yourself, let's repeat those words of that father. Lord, I believe. Help me with my doubt. Be it unto you according to your faith. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, our doubts, our questions, God is quick to understand, to forgive us, and to affirm us, and to love us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup, and after supper, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the remission of your sin. This do as often as you eat and drink, in proclamation and remembrance of Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. Amen. Please follow the direction of the volunteers and come forward to receive the Lord's Supper.
How deep. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I'll stand.
Bold testimony of faith. Dave, they're throwing flowers at you. That's amazing. Incredible. May this, the true body and the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given under forms of bread and wine for us Christians to eat and drink, may it serve to strengthen and preserve you ever steadfast in saving faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Will you join with me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, the series continues next week with Where in the World is God? You know, if God is good, why does he allow evil to exist in the world? We're going to tackle that difficult question next week as we continue our series called Puzzled. Hope you'll be back for it and invite others to come back with you. It'll be an interesting series for them. It'll challenge their thinking. And if you travel and can't be with us, then we encourage you to also watch online through our live stream. Receive the blessing of the Lord. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God our Heavenly Father, and the constant abiding presence of His Holy Spirit be and remain with you always. Amen. Depart in peace and serve the Lord.